use it for your glory.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
And we can all say amen.
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 We're gonna see some of our kids. In my sight. Yeah, our kids will present their memory verses that we call verse Malachi, the legend. He will recite not only a few verses, he will recite the whole chapter of Psalms 146. And he told me that when I die, he will be the pastor of this church. I don't even disagree. That's him.
Right.
bring it near to you.
You can read it. Right there. You can read it.
Finally, brother, whatsoever things were related, whatsoever things. Microphone. Joseph, excuse me, I repeat it. Will you?
Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are noble, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. The things which you have learned and received, heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace shall be with you.
Amen. Thank you. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, kids. So, I canceled your Sunday school, so you're going to be joining us all throughout. So, okay. So I'll just give you a brief summary of the things that our group is doing. We are only 3 years old, and we were this ministry, this church, or this group's been born during the COVID. When COVID was ravaging many places. So we have, small as we are, but we have a lot of ministry outreaches in the Philippines and also in Cambodia. And just to show you a few of them, we do feeding program. We have fed at least, I can say, about 1,500 kids in different places in the Philippines and also in Cambodia. And this was done just recently, December and January, so, you know, when we feed children in the Philippines, we always enjoy the best food that God created, and that is rice. So these are just some of them that we did in Mangaldan, Pangasinan. Then we also are doing a supporting a feeding program in San Felipe, Zambales, and also in Olongapo under Pastor J.P. Talcasino. And these are the kids, we told the pastors, incorporate the gospel. We will not only feed the children and their parents with the gospel, with physical food, but also we're going to share them the gospel, which is the most important part of these outreaches. And you may not know it, you will never meet these children in this life in person, but when you meet them in heaven, they will be thankful to you that partnership in this ministry, you made these children happy. Not the only good thing about doing this in the Philippines, unlike here in the U.S., in the Philippines, they don't have such thing as the separation of church and state. Okay, when you invite the children and they found out that their children are being blessed, being taken care of in the church, the parents can easily receive the gospel. And that is our main intent in feeding these children. So this are they in Zambales and Olongapo, and then this is in Cambodia. We have at least 18 Filipino who are English teachers in one village or two villages in Cambodia, but they are believers. Not only that they are teaching in schools in Cambodia, but they are in their free time, they are also ministering the gospel to many of the orphans, to many of the people in the villages. And these are the couple who are leading the team. Clemson is a brother of our worship leader, Francis, and that's his wife, Anne. And these are the Filipino teachers, school teachers, English teachers, who are all working together to evangelize. It's not an easy place to evangelize because Cambodia is a Buddhist country, and yet God has opened the door for them to present the gospel to the villages, and there are some town or village officials that are supporting them in what they are doing. So these are in Cambodia, these are the kids in Cambodia. So they are praying or singing before they do the meal, and they are also being taught some lessons as they do that. And then in December 24, Christmas, this is in South Cotabato, mostly a Muslim part of the Philippines in the south, under Pastor Efrain Nagmay, we were able to bless 30 families with groceries. Pastor Efrain is the one on the right, and his wife is the one down below there on your left. So, yeah, they enjoyed it. 30 families in, were a recipient of our blessing, and they were able to have groceries and Noche Buena and Buena Noche during Christmas and New Year's Eve. So these are they happily doing it, and those are the goods. This is a tribe in Pampanga. Most of these people I'll be showing you, these are natives of the Pinatubo. The Pinatubo is the mountain, is the volcano that erupted in 1993. The U.S. base, the military U.S. base is not so far from that place in Pampanga. And as you can see, they're just cooking it with firewoods, but they're happy doing it. So we fed 182 children with their parents in that tribe, in Pampanga and Pinatubo. Some of them came down from the mountain to participate in here. And they're growing as a church, as a ministry. They're growing. These are the people, these are the kids. If you will notice, their skin are a little bit darker because they live in the mountain. And then not only that, we were also able to send boxes of school supplies in some of the tribes in the Philippines. And those are the boxes. And we're doing it again. In just 3 weeks from now, we're going to ship at least 4 or 6 more boxes of kids' school supplies in Pangasinan. This time in Pangasinan, there will be about 129 school children, mostly a grade school, from 1st to 6th grade, will receive school supplies, from backpack, crayons, and you name it. So these are the last year. And those were the bags, and the bags are loaded with what they need in the Philippines. And that's the pastor there in Pinatubo, Pastor Jay. And these are some of the kids. So like I said, we're going to do this in 3 weeks. And there's already a lot of our friends here who have donated for this effort or this endeavor that we're going to do. School year in the Philippines start August, and it takes about 90 days. For those boxes from here, 90 days, so 3 months to get there in the Philippines. So if we ship them April, most likely they're going to get it before school comes August of this year. So again, thank you so much. And this is the tribal outreach in South Cotabato. We were able to feed them, give them supplies. This is in one of the mountains in South Cotabato. That we are also helping. They're giving goods, they're giving groceries, and these are the three pastors of the different tribes there in Cotabato, where we're also giving them some rice and some supplies and some good things that we can give them. And that's Pastor John Albert Cerveza, the older brother of our Susan here, Cerveza here, and those are the three pastors. So we were also able to give Christmas toys in those tribes in Cotabato last year. So, and these are the recipients of our toys. These are tribal kids, and they're so happy to get all those toys. And again, those are out of your good heart that we were able to do all of this. And these are just some of the toys that we were able to send. Look at the smile in their face. And then there is a tribal church, and you will not believe this, America 21st century, you will not believe that in this church, every Sunday service, they sit on the floor. They don't even have benches like what you're saying. We donated these wooden benches, and it is the people in the church who constructed them. They bought the lumber, they constructed those benches, but can you just imagine, for 2 hours you're sitting on the floor to worship God. If you have a hip surgery or 65 years old and so on, you can sit down. But the problem is a miracle for you to rise up. It takes a lot of prayer. But you see, but out of your generosity, we were able to to provide the benches in this particular church in the mountain. So, and this is the latest. The pastor just sent this 2 days ago. With our gift, they were able to do feeding program for the 6 consecutive weeks in Longus, Bacoor, Cavite, in the Costa Road, and also in Zapote. And these are the kids. So they're having Bible study first before they do the feeding. So since there are so many kids and their parents, so what they do, they just ration it. They pack them in boxes and give them to the kids. So I can say, hallelujah is a good word.
Amen.
But sometimes when you cannot use some words to thank God, hallelujah means praise the Lord. Hallelujah, because of our giving, we were able to reach, I'm telling you, thousands of kids in the Philippines because of your generosity. Okay? Your one venti cup of Starbucks, dark roast, will cost you $5.85. $5.85, you give it to me, I can feed 3 kids full meal. Okay? I'm not saying that you don't buy Starbucks. Okay? I'm not saying that you don't buy that. There is one just across the street. But I'm telling you, once you give an amount, US dollar, it extends about 55 times. One US dollar is 55 pesos. So you can feed, just your $5 can feed full meal, more than what you are seeing in the picture. Okay? So, and these are the other places. I have no time to show you some pictures. We have one in Santa Barbara, Pangasinan, an island in Northern Samar, another town in Pampanga, and 2 villages in Nueva Ecija, Dimba, and Cuyapo. So these are all the people, and this is ongoing, and we've been doing all of these things that I'm showing you in the past 3 years of our existence. So thank you so much. And then not only that, here in Jacksonville, we are partnering with the American Church who owns this facility. From time to time, they assign us to sponsor the soup kitchen where we feed some of the community people and some of the homeless people and those who are in need in the community within the radius of this church. So, and not only that, we also support their food pantry. They distribute groceries twice a month. I don't ask you guys to bring in canned goods, but we give them cash. So that the American Church will be the one, they know better on what particular groceries they're going to buy and distribute to the people. So, thank you for all your support. Keep on doing it. And now I will introduce you to our speaker. He came all the way from Melbourne, Australia, together with his son. And that's me in one of my visits there in Melbourne, Australia. That's me on the right. I look more handsome back then. Okay, but I've noticed, you know, sometimes you have a brother in the Lord, but sometimes you have both, a friend and a brother in the Lord, and he is one. In fact, he is one of our best men in our wedding, during our wedding. Don't ask me how many years. A lot of years. And then we were classmates in college. He has 2 bachelor's degree. I think sanitary engineering and civil engineering. I took mechanical engineering. I only have 1 degree, but praise the Lord. and this is us when we were about to graduate in college. Look at how many pounds we have gained. So you see, seven of us. All of us are engineering students back then: civil, electrical, mechanical, and he was also civil. 6 out of 7 in the picture turned out to be full-time pastors. So we and all of our friends there except 1, we are full-time pastors in the church. Yeah. So God used our degree in engineering. And that's him. That's our Pastor Mario. And that's our Brad Pitt. That's me. And one of my visits in Sydney, Australia, on the background is the Harbour Bridge and also the Sydney Opera House. And that's him again. And that's yours truly, Tom Cruise. And then Pastor Moore's brother, Pastor Jesse, also pastoring a church in Sydney, Australia. So God is a good God, and without much work to do, let's welcome Pastor Moore. It's good to be back here in Jacksonville. I've been here, I think, 12 years ago, 13 years ago, when I visited him. And yeah, and I thank God for this opportunity to be able to share the gospel with you. Amen. Okay, shall we bow down our heads, please, and let us pray. Father in heaven, I thank you, God, for the opportunity that we can always come unto your throne of grace through the blood of your Son Jesus. Lord, I pray as I share your words, we want to speak to each and every one and be glorified in our midst. Thank you, Father God. We bless and honor you. In Jesus' name we pray, let us all say,
Amen.
And let us come as the Lord. Maybe some of you know Lee Majors, the bionic eye. But don't worry. I'm okay. Hey, God is faithful. So I was asked to share about the faithfulness of the Lord. When I'm trying to meditate about the topic, I just ask, Lord, how can I share? God is faithful. And as I researched, I found that same question here. It says, how do you preach on the faithfulness of God? And the response was, to preach His faithfulness, show what it is. Isn't it? Show what it is. The first thing is this. I'd like to congratulate you all for having reached this third year anniversary. And by tomorrow, you'll be beginning your fourth year. I'm thinking the Bible numerics is that number three is completion. Okay, meaning to say, you were able to complete already the first part in the ministry. In our church, we have 24 outreaches in the Philippines, three in Kuwait, and Saudi Arabia, and then one in England, three in Australia, three different states. Our policy is that before we recognize you as a church, you should have reached the third year. So our recognized churches in the Philippines is 24. Okay, so excluding the new ones. And those 3 years is very important in the Bible and to us. In the Bible, when the Lord saw the fig tree that don't have fruits in it, what did the Lord says? Cut it down. If there's no fruit, cut it down. And look at you. Can you please congratulate the person near you? Look at you. Yeah. You reached the third year. And I could say, based on our experience, you are now a church. Hello? When you started 3 years ago, it's like a Bible study or having just like a club with eating, you know? And things like that, but then since you've reached the third year, you're now a church. Amen. Hello?
Amen.
Yes. Isn't it good?
Yes, sir.
And also, you now have a pastor.
Yes.
In the person of, you know that, Tom Cruise or?
Brad Pitt.
I say you have now a pastor. It takes 3 years for a pastor to be called really a pastor, based on study. And he's been pastoring for 3 years now. I would say he's a pastor. That okay? Amen. Yeah. When we were classmates in the university, I don't like him. Really don't like him. I really wanna... Yeah, a lot of times I sit at the front, or no, in the second row. Every time at the front, He sits on the second row and he speaks always like that. And look at him. But I could not punch him. You know why? His friends are 6'2", 6'3". How can I do that? And he lives just 3 minutes away from the university. I'll be in trouble. Anyway, also, after a few, I think, months, maybe a year or two, I saw him in the church, in the fellowship where we were attending. And I said, who's that man? Lord, for what reason he got saved? He's here. You know, knowing him when he was young, oh no, you will not like him. And I thank God. But then, God uses him, you know, to push me in the ministry, meaning to be a missionary. Because when I was still working as a senior technical analyst at the National Housing Authority during the early 80s, and we had that planning in, I think, Darana Falls, somewhere in the south. I had that dream. And in that dream, I saw a verse in the sky which says, from henceforth thou shalt tax men. That's it. That's the only thing. And I saw myself like getting all the fish that's dying in the river, putting it in the a banca, you know the one? Then I asked him, we've been friends already. Thank God, God changes for the people. Yeah. And he said to me, bro, you know what? Those people whom God says, from henceforth thou shalt catch men, they were used by the Lord. And that's the beginning of it. That's the beginning of it. I began to think about it. Then eventually, I resigned from work and I went to the mission field in Lucena City. So our church started in Lucena City, south of Manila. Those of you are familiar in the Philippines. And that's the beginning, that's way back 1985. And after now, I'm still doing mission work. I'm still traveling, going places and planting churches. And that's my calling. As a missionary, to plant church, raise up leaders, and eventually, I will lead that to them. The church that we have in Melbourne, when it reached, I think, the 10th year, and the Lord already spoke to me, and I leave it to the next generation leaders. We have another lead pastor. In Sydney, we also have another lead pastor, and the senior pastor is my brother. And that's what I do. I know my calling. So all of us should know our calling. We should know our purposes in life. Otherwise, we're hitting a wall. Amen? If you don't know where you're going to, any road will take you there. Now, I'm sharing these things because God is so faithful to our church here. God is so faithful to you. You were able to reach the 30. Not many churches who have started were able to reach 3 years. Now, and this is the challenge. The challenge now is you'll be starting the 4th year. And the number 4 is a new beginning. Okay? And I also put meaning in each and every number. The first year in the ministry, I called it the honeymoon stage. You know, we laugh, you know, we're not laughing and doing, you know, having some fun. So anyways, we just love it. I call it the honeymoon stage. And everyone is happy. On the second year of the ministry, now you can try to recall if you've been here for 3 years already. The second year of ministry is, I call it like a building up relationship year. Where you begin to know not only the name. Am I right? Oh, you know already where the person lives. Sometimes you know about the birthday, you do it, probably you've been invited, you begin to know the person. And the third year, okay, listen to this, the third year I call it the building up of character year. There will be people who will be with you that you don't like the character. And still you have to love the person. Look at the person near you. Do you like him or her?
Yes.
And you will be able to hear also people saying things, maybe pro or against, but you have to live with it. After all, they are brothers and sisters.
Amen.
Amen. And that's the time that God will build our character. Hello?
Amen.
For those people who can't stand with their brothers and sisters, they just leave. I don't want out of the church anymore. That person is so talkative. You know? I don't want out of the church anymore. That person always eat a lot. You know what I'm saying? Or he's always eating without bringing anything. You can always hear people complaining. See, and that's the third year. There will still be more. But we have to learn. Amen. And that's part of growing up as a Christian. I'm sharing these things because God is so faithful to you. Now, this fourth year, be prepared for a new beginning. Now, this fourth year, God will lead you in a direction maybe you didn't plan to go. Because I always remember God had given me this Christmas card, and I think that was written in that Christmas card. God may lead us in a way we didn't plan to go, but He knows what is best. Amen. Maybe you were not able to plan it yet, but God will lead us in that direction. And who knows? After the first impression to me, when I arrived, I think last Wednesday night here in Jacksonville, me and my son said, can you please stand up? My third child, okay, we have five children. The first three are girls, and they're all married. The last are boys. They don't have girlfriends yet. The youngest is taking up a PhD in construction management, finishing this year. God willing. And because of him, I was able to come here. He paid all the fares and everything. All the way traveling from different places. And I thank God, God is so good. You see? Now, this year, be prepared for what God will do in this church. As I said earlier, there's something that deep within me that I could really feel. I may be wrong, but I hope I'm right. That very soon, you will have your own place.
Amen.
You're not belonging yes. anymore.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay. I would say don't think too much. You know, too much analysis leads to paralysis. Oh, I'll be retiring, I will not have much time anymore, you will not be able to give anymore, things like that. Through the years, if God says so, He will do it.
Amen.
Our church in Queensland, Australia, that's another state, in 2 year time, they were able to buy their own property with a few people. God says so. Father, they are now on the fourth year this year. They have paid everything. No more loan. You see how good God is? Why? Because God says so. Amen. It takes faith. And not only faith, it takes courage to do so. Are you happy with that?
Yes.
Yeah? Or maybe some people say, yes.
Yes.
I think one thing that my brother forgot is my water. Okay, I'm not starting yet. I'm just about to begin. Faithfulness. That's the key word. God is faithful. Let's see the meaning of the word faithfulness. The fact or quality of being true to one's word or commitment. The fact or quality, okay, of being true to one's word or commitment. It is very important to know the person. And you can only trust the person if the person is faithful. Having said true to his word, even when he committed something, he'll do it. Isn't it? It's good to be with somebody like that. But it's a lot better, and I think the best, we'll be knowing the God whom we serve is a faithful God. I could tell stories upon stories with you. Which is, from the beginning I said, how would you preach faithfulness? Then show me this. It means tell stories. In the Philippines, there's a saying that I hope you won't mind, I'll say it in Tagalog first. It says like this, kung wala kang kwento, wala kang kwenta. Okay, in English, if you don't have a testimony to share your experience with the Lord, your Christianity is empty, or you're not. Are you with me? If you have been a Christian for quite a while, I pray that God has worked in your life and you have something to share, but God has changed in your life. Amen. Then you can say, God is faithful. Amen? Okay. Faithfulness, can you please read this one? 1, 2, 3, read. Faithfulness of God is foundational to our faith. You see, I'm going to share to you my experiences or our experiences, because remember the experiences, but it has no power. It may help you, it may lead you to think something or stimulate your thinking and things like that, but it has no power. What has power is the Word of God. Amen. So I'd like to start with this, to lay the foundation. See, faithfulness of God is foundation to our faith. If we can trust what He says in the Bible, then we have no reason to believe. Are we reading the Word of God? If not yet, we should. Or buy your car, or sell your car and buy a Bible. You should read the Bible, the Word of God. Because the Bible says, the sword of the Spirit is what? The Word of God. In Ephesians chapter 6. The sword of the Spirit is the Word of God. If you don't know anything in the Word of God, how would you tell that God is faithful? If you don't know His promises, if you don't know His Word. See? How would you tell that you trust God? You see? If we can trust what He says, matter if we're not reading the Bible, how would you know what He's trying to say to us? If you want to grow in your spiritual life, read the Word of God. Are you with me?
Yes.
Amen. I remember this man. Anybody here who knew Derek Prince? Okay. Derek Prince is a gifted person. He's smart, so intelligent. I think at the age of 9 he knew Greek. At the age of 10 he knew already Hebrew. He became a fellow in Cambridge University at the age of 19. He had read so many books except the Bible. But when the Second World War came, he was sent to war, and the only thing that he could bring with him is the Bible. And that is where it all started. Now, he was invited to a family for a dinner, and he didn't know that this family is a Christian. And of course, before you eat, what do you do?
Pray.
You pray. Amen?
Amen?
And the different thing with that family is when they pray, all of them pray, one at a time. And when his turn came, the only word that he says, Lord, if you are there, teach me to believe. And that was the beginning, and he read the Word of God, and that changes his life. He became known actually throughout the world. You can Google his name and then read his books. They're really good, easy to understand. The English are easy to understand. And that's the beginning. You see, if we started reading the Word of God, it will help us grow in our faith. Amen. You do not go to a fight without any ammunition or anything that you could hold on to fight the enemy. If he doesn't keep his word, then our salvation is shaky and our hope is empty. I think Isaiah 55 verse 11, it says in there, the words that comes out of the mouth of God, it shall not return unto him void, but it shall accomplish the things which he pleases. Meaning everything that is written in the word of God, it shall come to pass. It will happen.
Amen.
Amen. It will happen. See, and you can use it in your personal life, in your family, anywhere you go, you can use it. Because there's power in the word of God.
Amen.
But if God, does fulfill his promises, then our faith is meaningful and our eternal destiny is secure. I remember way back in 2004, I suffered from stroke. The 1 week before, Fernando Jr. suffered from stroke also. We were 1 week apart. I suffered from stroke first, and half of my body paralyzed. I pee on a catheter. There's no power in my left part of the body, my face, you know, like that, before, and my tongue is strong, and I could not speak like this. And that night, I prayed to God. That night. It's a good thing that, you know, my wife took me to the hospital. We were in Makati after taking up the English exam because we were preparing to migrate in Australia. After all those pains I've done, I suffered from stroke. And then my wife said, let's go to the hospital. She just took me to Makati Med. You know what? Women have instincts that men don't understand. Sometimes we have to listen to them. Hello? Yes, it's true. They have instinct. Then in the hospital, I'm praying with my mind. I could not speak anymore. And in my mind, I thought, I'm talking to the Lord, look at me. I'm your son. And you are my father. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. But look at me. I'm like a vegetable. I can't speak. I can't walk. I can't, you know. If I will just be like this, Lord, take my life. What will the people say with the God I'm serving if I will be just like this? That's it. Those things to the Lord. Sometimes you might think, we have 5 children, and how about what will happen to my wife? You know, I used to have a construction firm in the Philippines during those times. And I also do mission work. I'm a missionary. I work and I pastor. Okay? To others, it's not, they don't like it. But then, you know, this is what we call a bivocational pastor. Why? I work to feed my family, to support my family, and at the same time, I don't want to be a burden to the church. I don't want to wait for the decision that if I want to go there and do mission work, and I will wait for the decision of the leadership, it will take too long. So I save money so that I can go where God needs me to go. Now, in saying that, if I die, what will happen to them? Now, that question was answered by the Lord earlier, or maybe years back, when I asked God, Lord, if I die, are you talking that way to the Lord? Mm-hmm. Now you can talk to God too. God will answer you. Maybe not in an audible voice, but God will speak to your mind. It will impress you. That will impress something in your life. And then when I said, Lord, ipang mo ang Filipino. Okay, not yet. I have not suffered yet at stroke. What will happen to my family? My pictures and jewelry brothers are very young. And there are five of them. And then the Lord answered, who love your family more? Is it you or me? And I said, you, Lord. Oh, so what's your problem? Hello? And then that's the area. So, and that night I said, if I will just be like this, half of my body paralyzed, you'll take my life. But I did not stop there. But, if you will still use me, then restore my health. The following day, I woke up very late in the morning, and I said to my wife, I'm going to the toilet. Or to the bathroom, you call it here. She said, don't you come? I'm going to the toilet. And she saw me step down from the bed and walk to the toilet.
Wow.
From that day, November 21, 2004, up to now, I'm walking. I did not even have the what is called this therapy or something. No. God is faithful.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. He is true to his words.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
See. Praise the Lord. Come on. Keep going. Yes. Give it to the Lord. So, as I've said earlier, I'd like to lay the foundation. And there must be something that we could hold on, you know, which is the Word of God. In Deuteronomy, I think chapter 7, verse 9. Okay, let us read this all together. With a loud voice, please, 1, 2, 3, read. Next verse. I think there are three verses in it. How about to read?
God is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord.
And the last one?
He who holds you is faithful, who also will do it.
So there's still so many verses that I could share to you. But I just wanted to show to everyone that God is faithful. Now, to whom God is faithful? So we have read these verses, and it says in there, to whom God is faithful. So God is faithful, one,
to those
who love Him. Can you please ask the person near you, do you love God? Now don't wait for the response, just ask the question. Okay? Another thing, God is faithful
to those who keep
His commandments. Amen.
Amen.
I believe you remember this in Joshua chapter 1 verse 8.
Yes.
When Joshua took the leadership from Moses, but Moses died already. And God said, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate it therein day and night, and you shall make your way prosperous. Now you take to know the words. If we meditate the word of God, okay, is it God who will make us prosperous? Actually, it's us. Is it this book of the law, you can open your Bible if you want to, shall not depart out of your mouth. You shall meditate it therein day and night, and you shall make your way prosperous. Who will make you prosperous? Yourselves. What's your basis? The Word of God. Because you will use the Word of God to help you in your job, in your businesses. You know, me as an engineer. I think I pastor Tindray Sili, pastor. Okay, he's also a contractor in the Philippines. And he knows what I'm talking about. When we're building structures, there's a marker. Okay, where, how far you run will be. And then in that marker, when you build houses, you don't go to the middle. Because although your land is up to the middle of that marker, you move a little back. Say like about an inch, but you still have to do plastering. If you put your bricks at the center of that marker, and if you do the plastering, you take already a part of the land of the neighbor, isn't it? Something like that. It's in the Bible. Then you don't, even you don't move marker. So, God is the best architect and the best engineer.
Amen.
Amen. Those commandments help me in my business as a, you know, a construction owner, in the company, and be able to do it the right way. And there are times, okay, most of the time, the client will complain. And the client complain, like in one instance, I built a big house. And then we did this tile work, the roofs and the tiles. It's almost complete, and then the owner said, "Oh, I think it's wrong. We have to remove it and change it again." He has his own architect, and the architect instructed me to do it that way. It's not my fault really, technically. But then I just asked him, because I know that person is a Christian, is it, if it seems to you that it is right to remove it and replace it to a new one, I'll do it. But if not, if you think it's not right, then I'll give you a tomorrow if you want me to remove it. I'm not afraid to do that kind of thing, but I think he said, knowing it's not my fault, I'm doing the right thing. The following day he said, no, it's okay. Just innocent. You see, why? That is, good is different from right. Let me repeat. No, the Bible says we do the good, what is good, and the right thing.
Amen.
Amen. So there's so many things I could share to you as an example. And as we keep His commandments, then we will be always in the right track, in the right path. Or the familiar verse like Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not depend on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path. Isn't it good? We don't need a compass or whatever. God will always direct our path. Okay. Who else? God is faithful to those who are called unto the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. If you haven't experienced yet the power of Christ in your life, now is your time. When I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior, decades ago, ever since that day, I'll say the date, February 13, 1980, I never thought of turning back. Because there's no other good thing that you could find in this world except in the Lord. Yes, sir. Now, if you know something else, please let me know. I will go with you. But there is none. God will give us peace beyond understanding. Amen. God will supply all our needs according to His riches and glory. God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think of, according to the power that works in us. And more so is this. You can buy crucifix, but you cannot buy salvation. Or you can buy a good bed, silk bed, water bed, but not a good sleep. Only God can give that. You can buy a good medicine, but not health. Only Jesus can give that. Amen. If you want to experience the Lord, it's just so simple. First, accept that we have sinned against God. By the way, anybody in here who have not sinned? Well, praise the Lord, there's nobody who raised up their hand. The Word of God says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Amen? You don't have to say it or tell it. All of us have sinned. But God is gracious. The gift of God, okay, is salvation to us by faith. The gift of God is eternal life through His Son, Jesus. Ephesians 2:8 says, for by grace we have been saved through faith, not of our good works, lest any man should boast. Meaning, I say, if somebody is rich or build a hospital for the poor, houses for the homeless, they will go to heaven. That would be unfair. How about the poor people? So salvation, you don't have to really work hard. Just have to believe what Jesus has done on the cross of Calvary. This Sunday is called Palm Sunday, isn't it? That's in the Bible. And people prepare the time of the Lord Jesus and go to the temple. Although I haven't read in the Bible, I hope you won't mind, that I experienced once, I was in the car, or riding in a bus, and I saw people who have black on their head. That's one I haven't read in the Bible yet, for so many years. Okay? But the thing is, when I was us, I shared earlier, I used to lecture in the university. And before I lecture, I shared the gospel. Say, 25 minutes. And after that, I will ask them if they have questions. And one of them asked questions. He said, sir, what can you say about the thing that blocked on the forehead that was asked Wednesday? I really don't know the answer. But I will answer your question with a story and a question too. Because I have read this book, this book written by Richard Boomerang. Anybody knows him? Okay, from Romania. And in the book says, there's a fly that falls on the holy water. What happens to the water? Okay, the water becomes dirty, or the fly becomes saint. It's the same thing. You put an ash on your forehead. What happens to you? Did you become saint, or is your forehead become dirty? I say, you don't have to respond. Hello? See, only Jesus can change our life.
Amen.
And have that faith in the Lord. Not to Pastor Eddie, not to the church, but to the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I said earlier, if you haven't tried it, you have tried so many things in your life, this time try Jesus. He will do tremendous changes in your life, as what He did to us. Amen.
Amen.
I remember that song, you can search the whole world, and you will be just as before, until you find the longing of your soul. It's in Jesus.
Yes.
Only Jesus can change our life. Your parents cannot change you. Your spouse cannot change you. Your siblings cannot change you. Only God can change you.
Amen.
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 Praise the Lord. Let us come right for the Lord. I hope you can bear with me. I asked Pastor Eddie, how long will I preach? He said, okay, it's up to you. Oh, praise the Lord, hallelujah. I can tell, so is that. I'm preaching in one of the colleges in Australia. Only 10 minutes. We are preaching to the teachers and staff. Every Friday, we are talking to pastors, preaching every Friday. And in that minutes, 10 minutes, finish or not finish?
Pass your paper.
Pass your paper. You have to stop. So I have to prepare everything in 10 minutes. But then I was given the like a blank check here.
Are you still with me? Or are you afraid now? Okay, let's continue on. Okay? I pray, okay, before I continue on, I asked earlier, and if you haven't accepted Jesus yet as your personal Lord and Savior, you can pray a simple prayer. I think it would be better for me to help you now. Yes, yes. Okay, for those who have been to Christian before, and there's something going in your life, you can pray also with us. I lead you to prayer, follow the same words, and just mean it to your heart. Okay? So we bow down our head, just close your eyes, focus on the Lord, and say these words after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity that I can come to you. Today, I accept I am a sinner and I need you. I am opening my heart to you. Come and live with me and be my Lord and Savior. Forgive me from all my sins and all my iniquities. Thank you, Lord, for you have said in your words that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us. Thank you, Lord, for the forgiveness of my sins. I will pray for you. Lord, I'm praying for these people, Lord God. What you have done in our lives, do the same thing to them and more, Lord. And show them, Lord God, to grow in the faith, and yet let your grace be upon them, Lord God, to understand your words. Thank you, Father God, be with them, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That simple prayer, try to remember it tonight. And then talk to the Lord. And then ask the Lord. You can ask whatever you want. And I pray the very issues that you have, God will respond to all your issues. We as pastors, we may not be able to answer all your questions. Or maybe we may not be able to help you in all your needs. But God, wherever you are, can help you.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, we can proceed now. A life devoted to things is a dead life, a stump. A God-shaped life is a flourishing tree. So if you have started now, accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you've been a Christian for quite a while, have that commitment, that desire, to commit your life to the Lord. There's one thing that I've learned. If you want to grow in your spiritual life, I would say to mature in your spiritual life, then commit yourself in the church.
Yes.
Do you agree with that?
Yes.
This may be confusing, but I would say, you will never mature in your spiritual life if you will not have commitment. Why did I say that? You see, if you're just attending in the church, okay, and the issues come, you can just easily leave. It is easy to change church than to change character. Hello? It is easy to change church than to change character. Is it okay? You're so quiet. God will chase us. God will chase us. And, we live in a developed country. Like in Australia, it's a developed country. And there's so many things that this world will offer to us. Material things. That's why there are people who work two jobs, three jobs, always trying to earn money. As if they will die, they will not have money. And I've seen those things in my life. It's not bad to work. But if you will just work all your life, the Bible says it's a dead life. See, a life devoted to things is a dead life. If you don't have Christ with you, if you don't have that spiritual desire in you to grow, it is a dead life. No matter how much money you will have. Are you with me? I'm not very rich. Or I say I'm not rich, but my father is very rich. Okay? I would say, I have so many classmates here in America. They're wealthy. They have very good position. One worked in the federal government as an environmental engineer. I could say so many things. And one thing I say is this. I may not have that kind of wealth that they have, but my life is complete.
Amen.
I have 5 children. They're all in the ministry. They have finished school. Isn't it good? And especially this time. Yeah, look at him. He paid everything. Airfare and name it. Isn't that a blessing?
Yes.
I don't have a car. Really, I don't have a car. I used to have, but now I don't have a car. But I can say I have many drivers. Yeah. Yesterday, I had a driver who drives a Honda. Today, I have another driver who drives a Toyota, I think. You see? I don't pay the insurance. I don't put petrol. I don't register any car at all. You see, God is so good.
Amen.
Amen. That's how good God is.
Yes.
See, don't put all your energy in just earning money. Our God will supply all our needs.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Okay. If you can say amen to that, and then think about it again. But if you can say amen, then God will test your amen.
Yeah.
Okay. I could think on. I may be, I used to do this thing, but at least today I forgot. I used to remove my wax, put it in here, so that I will not be too long. I remember the saying, if you preach short, you shall be invited again. Right. I'll be quick now. 5 ways to learn. Okay? This is the part of the faithfulness of God. We can learn in 5 ways. There's so many ways to learn, but I'll just share 5 things. One, we can learn by being taught, like in school, or like in here, probably. I'm teaching. Or maybe God will use somebody else to teach you. See, that is always by others. But if people say, you learn from the book, at least somebody wrote the book. It's not just the pen. There must be somebody who wrote it. So that's one way to learn, by being taught. If we are, at least by others. 2, we learn by observation. And this is, if we are alert. I give example. Is it okay for me to ask question? I'll ask this one. Yeah. You know the traffic light? Have you seen the traffic light? How many colors can you see the traffic light? Tommy? You wait. Okay. How many colors is the traffic light? 3. Okay. Which color is in the top? You sure?
Let's
give a clap. If you're not alert, you don't know what the color on the top. Hello? You just see, you can only see the traffic light. But which color? The red or the green on the top? Or I remember Pastor Eddie told me the definition of the yellow one. What's the meaning of the yellow one, Pastor Eddie? Hurry up! Hurry up! It's so different. I drove from Orlando going to Cape Canaveral. I saw 70 miles per hour. I'm driving 70 miles per hour. I'm surprised. Everyone is overtaking me. What's wrong in this country? It's true. In Australia, you will lose your license. Yeah, no matter whether you are a minister or a premier or a president, if you, especially if you drink drive, you lose your license. And that's hard. That's why when I saw 70, I'm driving 70. Anyway, so if we are alert, we should always be alert and we can learn. Amen. Another way to learn is this. We learn by repetition, where most people, all people don't like. The ability. If I said to you something like this and then I repeat it again and I repeat it, how would you feel? Oh, come on, Pastor. One more time and you gotta say something. We don't like repetition. But look at the kids, our children. The best way for them to learn is through repetition. Isn't it? Sometimes it's good that something to be, for us to be reminded of. Even Paul himself, in one of his epistles, he said, I know that you know what I'm going to tell you, but I'm not tired of saying these things to you over and over again. And that's a paraphrase thing, but it's in the Bible. Okay? Sometimes it has to be repeated for us to be reminded. Do you like to be being reminded? Yes. Once is enough. Two will be too much. Three is a person that I can tell you now. Don't be afraid that sometimes, even in preaching, maybe what I'm sharing to you, you've heard already. But every time you hear the word of God, there will always be a new nugget of gold in there. Amen. That God will speak to you. And I know for a fact that not everything you will remember. Not everything. But at least remember one thing this afternoon. One thing that speaks to you. And don't forget it. Is that okay? There is one thing, I'm sure about it. If we are listening, okay, if we pay attention, there will be at least one thing that God will speak to us. Not many, but there will be at least one. Okay. When I was still lecturing, you see why I'm always moving? I go from here to there. Because I want to see those people who's following me. If your head is not turning and not following me, that means you must be dreaming. Okay? Or you must be, I don't know. And that's what I'm trying to do. Okay, I said five, we're going to three. Let's go to number four. Hands off the guitar. That's real. Repetition. And, I would say the adult ones. Most often, you don't like. Number four. This is a hard part. We learn by failures. Failure teaches us how not to do it. I think you remember Thomas Alva Edison. He's the one who invented this incandescent lamp. And somebody says, he failed 10,000 times. And he said, no, I did not fail 10,000 times. I learned how not to do it 10,000 times. Hello? See, it teaches how not to do it. If we will not learn from our failures, then what is the use of failing? If you have read the book of John Maxwell about failing forward. And he said this words, the failing forward. If we will not learn from our failures, what is the use of failing? You should learn from those things. If we have learned something, that means we did not fail. We learned something. Amen.
Amen.
See, it's very important. Sometimes we are, you know, we're so sad. If you have learned something, you did not fail. Maybe it cost you something, but you did not fail. And the last one is this. We learn by going through experientially. This is a lot harder than number four. When you go through experience. For God to reveal Himself to us. Okay. I'll go back. We should go through experience for God Himself to reveal Himself to us. I remember Moses in the book of Exodus. After crossing the Red Sea, okay, and then they successfully crossed the sea, and then they're happy, they're even singing, and then after a few days, they run out of water. And the people are murmuring. Imagine millions of them, and then they're murmuring against us, a leader. We don't have, why did you bring us here? We don't have anything to drink, blah, 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 blah. And then the Lord led them to a river called Marah. And the word Marah in the English word is bitter. So they could not drink it, even though their cattle could not drink the water. The Lord said to Moses, get that tree and throw it to the water. When he did it, the water becomes sweet. And all of them were able to drink. What did Moses learn? He learned that God is the healer. Even the water, He heals the water. And being bitter. See, that is how we learn. Through those experiences. When Abraham brought his son to be offered, his son Isaac. Imagine the only son. God promised Abraham, you will be the father of many nations. And then he will offer his son. Think about it. It's incomprehensible. But when he got to the mountain and is about to offer his son Isaac, the Lord stopped him. And he saw this, what do you call the one? That he could offer. And that is where he learned that God is the provider for Jehovah Jireh. So through those experiences, you will learn something that He is my God. He is my healer. He is my provider. But during the time of experience, it's hard. It's hard. Last year, I don't know if Pastor Eddie knows this one. Last year, early last year, year 2023, I always go to my GP or doctor, and have the checkup. And then, it was before we did the conference in San Mateo itself, January, February. And the result of the blood test is that my PSA count goes higher. I don't know what PSA means. I don't know if I could eat that or what. But it's about
specific antigen.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't know the one. He says your PSA is higher, so I suggest you go to you should have like an ultrasound to check your prostate. Because I'm doing, you know, a lot of things and also preparing for the conference in the Philippines. I just forgot about it. And then my GP referred me to this specialist. I was not able to give him a result because I did not follow his advice. And this specialist, after coming back sometime April, I talked to the specialist and he said to me, okay, you were scheduled last time to have that your prostate will be shaved so that you'll be able to pee, you know, easily. But I would suggest to you, let's not do that. Let's start from the beginning. Another test, and then you could have your MRI. It's evaluated. So I did those things. About, I think sometime September or October, we remember, we will have another conference. So I have to apply again. The result came out. And the result of the three areas where I was tested with MRI all says, highly likely I have a cancer. All the three. Even my doctor said to me, he said, I have to get that result from my doctor. He said, in all likelihood, you have a cancer. And we are talking about how to, you know, the treatment. There's so many things that he said, like hormonal, something like that, or chemo, or about radiation. Explain to me all those things. How would you feel if you have heard your doctor saying you have a cancer? And even the results of the test confirms that we have a cancer. How would you feel? What would you think? Maybe it will become a torture to your mind, isn't it? But in those times, that every time I'll think about that I have a cancer, I've learned something. I don't want to accept it. I know that I pray for your healing. Every night, I'm praying for my healing. A simple prayer, Lord, heal my prostate. And then I did request for the prayer warrior. I know you have prayer meetings, something like that. I did ask a prayer for them, for me to be healed. Then the next step, December, I underwent this biopsy surgery. And imagine I would put this catheter again. Christmas time, New Year, I'm on a catheter. What can I do? And the good thing in Australia is that if you're like that and you're at home, they will send the community doctors in your house. We don't pay anything actually. In the hospital, with the doctor. To make the story short, early January, the representative from the specialist rang me and gave me the result. All the, I don't know probably how many tests that was done in my different areas of the prostate. He said all those tests that was done resulted in negative.
Wow.
Can you come up to the Lord? It's not me, neither the doctor, but it's through prayers that God can heal us. And not only that, if you are in a situation like that, God will teach you how to change your mind, your thinking. See, Romans 12 says, I think in verse 2, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you will know what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. When you say you will renew your mind, is it just like changing the channel of the television? You don't like what you're watching, you change the channel. Isn't it? Meaning to say, if you will renew your mind, there must be a replacement. You do not just renew that you change the thinking. There must be a replacement. And the best replacement is the Word of God. His promises. And you find that God is faithful. He is true to His promises. He will fulfill what He says. Amen. Remember, I said earlier, Ephesians 3 verse 20. God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we will ever ask or think of, according to the power that works in us through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
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 I pray that this year you will be able to experience the power of God. You will be able to experience more His faithfulness. Now, this is my last slide here. Ecclesiastes 11 verse 5. Just as we cannot understand the path of the wind or the mystery of a tiny baby growing in its mother's womb, so you cannot understand the activity of God who does all things. There may be a situation that will come in your life that you will find it hard to understand. Maybe you can explain. Just continue on. Even though it's hard, you still walk. Even if you crawl, you continue on. But never, never think about stopping. When you stop continuing, that is the same as you're turning back your back to the Lord. All of us will go through things in life. There will be wilderness in our spiritual life. But God is faithful. See, Psalms 37 says, I think verse 23, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. And he delights in his ways. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. You have questions in life? You talk to God. Isaiah 43 verse 26 says, the Lord is saying to each and everyone, come, let us reason together that you may be justified. You talk to him. When you read your Bible, that is that how you talk? Sometimes you're reading your Bible, you're having your devotion, like, oh, I think I'm gonna fart. Excuse me, Lord. You can still read it, you can still fart, God will understand. Are you with me? If he's your friend. I remember, Pastor Eddie, we have an appointment. We're gonna meet one day. And we have a scheduled day and time. And he did that thing. He didn't come. I'm really upset. He did that, fulfill his commitment for us with each other. And then the following week, I saw him. Oh, you didn't come to our, we talk about, we got to meet this day and time, blah, blah, blah. You know what he said to me? We're friends of friends forever. In the Lord of them. He just sing that song with him. What can you say? No, it's good to be a friend of God.
Amen.
You can just talk to him anytime, any place. Just talk to him. He's always with you. Amen.
Amen.
Is God faithful?
Yes.
God bless you.
Amen.
Okay, we're gonna do our opening. Again, I want to thank you on behalf of the group, the FFG family. I want to thank you all for coming out. It's a great blessing to us to celebrate this third year with this much attendance. And again, I want to thank some people have drove all the way from Arkansas to be here. Some have drove from Georgia to be here. Some from Panama City. So thank you so much. To all of you, thank you so much. So, we'll do our opening. So what we do, we come and fill the bags. And just remember, we're giving to God, and remember those children that we support in the Philippines. It is all through your generosity that we are able to do, help the pastors, their families, and also those thousands of children. So, let's pray. Lord, we honor you, we bless you, God, that we can give because we already received. I pray, God, that you will be honored, God, in our giving this afternoon. In Jesus' name, amen,
amen.
And amen.